I am not a historian, but neither are you. So, how about we the people learn this stuff together? Welcome to US 101. For today's episode, guys, if you're somebody that currently thinks that that they're a badass, you might want to reconsider that title after listening to today's story. Yes, 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 I know. I said time and time again that I am not a fan of themed months like Black History Month or Women's History Month. I'm not a fan of the fact that there are months designated to remember accomplishments done by certain groups of people, and then those accomplishments are forgotten about for the rest of the year. I think accomplishments should be celebrated year-round. However, I'll be goddamned if months like these don't make it easier to pick topics for episodes. Which is why for this week's episode, in honor of Women's History Month, I'm going to be regaling you with a tale of a true badass that defied all odds and expectations by fighting as a soldier in the Continental Army during the Revolutionary War. Because you must remember something, guys. Back then, during the Revolutionary War, the idea of women making their way anywhere near the battlefield in any sort of fighting capacity was unheard of. Come to think of it, there are still some people that think that women should not be fighting in any sort of war, should not be joining the infantry, which to me is just a dumb idea. But in the 18th century, during the Revolutionary War, women were relegated to duties that were more along the lines of like cleanup, right? They were cooks, they would clean up, they would serve as nurses and stitch up the soldiers that were fighting in the war. But the idea that a woman would dare grab a musket or fire a cannon was absurd. War is a gentleman's affair. There's no place for ladies on the battlefield. Nevertheless, this lady persisted. And in doing so, she not only carved her name into the annals of American history, but she also became a trailblazer for women in the military. So now that I've set it up for you guys, let's kick it off, man. Let's discuss the life of Deborah Sampson, who, in some respects, I refer to as the American version of Mulan. Y'all know who Mulan is. You guys have all seen the Disney movie. She's a Chinese girl. She's a daughter. And to stop her father from going to fight in a war, she suits up in her father's armor, disguises herself as a man, and makes her way towards the front line and gets down to business to defeat the Huns! Well, Deborah Sampson's story is similar in some respects, okay? She's born in Plimpton, Massachusetts in 1760, and she's the oldest of seven children. Now, because Deborah's father turns out to be a deadbeat dad, he actually ends up abandoning the family when Deborah is only 5 years old. And because Deborah's mom can't take care of all the children on her own, she sends the kids away to live with other relatives and with other families. So at age 10, Deborah Sampson becomes an indentured servant. Now, if you guys don't know what indentured servitude is, it's not slavery, but it's like one level higher. Basically, you sign a contract, you sign your life away for a certain amount of time, and during that time, you are in someone's house doing everything that they are asking you to do. So she becomes an indentured servant at age 10, and she finishes her servitude by the time she's 18 years old. And after she turns 18, for the next 2 years, she'll actually make her way in the world and earn a wage by becoming a school teacher. By now, it's the year 1781, and as the United States is still involved in a war with Great Britain via the Revolutionary War, Sampson decides that she wants to do a lot more with her life. She doesn't want to just, like, you know, just be a teacher and stay in the same place. She wants to go out and experience and see things and do things. And it turns out that all she needed in order to do that were clothes that men were typically wearing at the time. According to Deborah Sampson's biographer, Herman Mann, he wrote down that she made an outfit with all men's clothes, jacket, pants. She bought men's shoes, got men's hats, and she decided there and then that if she wanted to see new places and she wanted to experience things and have a bit of adventure, why not just join the military? Mann writes in Deborah Sampson's biography, quote, "This proposal concurred with her inclinations on many accounts. Whilst she would have equal opportunities for surveying and contemplating the world, she should be accumulating some lucrative profit, and in the end, perhaps, be instrumental in the cause of liberty." And just to let you know, Sampson's story isn't one of these, oh, and she took the brave step in signing up for the army disguised as a man, and even though she never saw action, her actions spoke louder than words. that. She saw death, she saw violence, and she took part in some as well. It's said that Deborah Sampson enlisted either in 1781 or 1782 under the name Robert Shurtleff, and she joined up with the 4th Massachusetts Brigade, and she would march from Massachusetts to West Point, New York. And she became a part of what were called the Light Infantry Troops, which was a group of soldiers that had to be more physically fit than others, right? They had to be fast, they had to be stealthy, and they were called light infantry because they were carrying a lot less with them. They were lighter on their feet, if you want. Additionally, in 1782, Sampson, now Robert Shurtleff, led a group of 30 soldiers in a skirmish against a group of Tories. If you guys don't know what Tories are, in the colonial times during the Revolutionary War, if you were a Tory, you were an American colonist, but you sympathized with the British. You were on the British side of the conflict. So Sampson and her guys get involved in this skirmish, and they win. They beat the Tories in the skirmish in 1782. But during that skirmish, Sampson, she suffers from a couple wounds, specifically a gash on her forehead that she received from a sword, and she catches a bullet in her left thigh. Now, normally, if one is wounded in battle, what's the first thing somebody's gonna cry out? They're gonna call, "Medic, I need some help. Please, somebody, please come help me so I don't die on this battlefield." But Sampson did not want to do this. She wanted to avoid going to any sort of hospital or getting any sort of medical treatment because if it was found out that she was a woman in the Continental Army, she would be kicked out, obviously. So here's what Sampson does, and this is, my God, okay, so she gets the gash on her forehead tended to because, you know, it's her head, so no one's gonna really see anything else. But then when it came to the bullet in her thigh, she actually snuck away and performed a little bit of self-surgery. What I mean to say is Sampson looked at the bullet wound in her left thigh, grabbed a penknife, and removed the bullet from her leg herself, and then stitched her own leg up with a sewing needle. We're talking no anesthetics, no alcohol, just dig in, grab it, and stitch yourself up and get back out there. If I stub my toe on the corner of my bed, I most likely will end up in the fetal position, curled up in the corner of my bedroom, calling out for my mom. And this injury did not hold Deborah Sampson back from serving, okay? Sampson, who actually would be nicknamed Molly by the guys in her troop because of her lack of ability to grow facial hair, she actually would serve in the Continental Army all the way up until 1783 before she's found out. While she was in Philadelphia in 1783, she was suffering from a really high fever. She got sick and she became unconscious. She blacked out because the fever was too much. So when the physician, one Dr. Barnabas Binney, is treating the soldier, Robert Shurtleff, he removes the clothing off of the soldier and he notices that the soldier, Robert Shurtleff, had bound his breasts close to his chest, thus finding out that Robert Shurtleff is actually a woman named Deborah Sampson. Now, while Sampson asked the doctor not to reveal her secret, eventually that secret would get out. A woman serving in the army, of course, that information is going to get out there. The truth was uncovered, and on October 25, 1783, Deborah Sampson, formerly known as Robert Shurtleff, was honorably discharged from the Continental Army. Now, after Deborah Sampson's stint as a soldier, she ends up getting married, and she ends up having 3 children and adopting a 4th one. But her story does not end by her just, you know, settling down and, the memories of fighting and glory. No, no, there's more to this. Having been a soldier and someone who fought and someone who bled for the country's independence, Sampson believed that she deserved some back pay for her service to her country. So in 1792, Sampson petitions the Massachusetts state legislature saying, I was in the army. I mean, I know against the rules, I'm not supposed to be in it, but I was, and I fought, and I bled, and I got hurt. So how about you hook me up with some of that money that I'm owed, huh? I was a soldier, pay me. And the Massachusetts state legislature agreed, and they rewarded her with a handsome back pay of 34 pounds. So since 34 pounds isn't really gonna help that much with the family's finances, in 1802, Deborah Sampson embarks on a speaking tour around America and talks to crowds about her time in the army. And at times she would dress up in the uniform that she wore. She would bring her musket on the road with her, and she would regale them with tales of her time on the battlefield. So now, having gained a little bit of fame from her speaking tour, Deborah Sampson petitioned Congress in 1804 for a full military pension. And this time she had a little bit of help from someone that was pretty well known during the Revolution. We all know him. He was a silversmith, and we also know him as a as a good man named Paul Revere. He came to her aid and he wrote on her behalf that she should receive this pension. And it worked, guys, because in 1805, Deborah Sampson became the only woman to receive a full military pension for her time as a soldier in the Revolutionary War. In the end, Deborah Sampson died at age 66 in the year 1827, and you can actually go visit her her headstone. She's buried in Sharon, Massachusetts, and if you look at her headstone, her epitaph reads the following: the female soldier. And that, my friends, is it for this episode of US 101. Again, if you thought you were a badass, go ahead and take a bullet to the leg and then remove that bullet from your leg yourself with no anesthetic, no help, using just a penknife and then sewing yourself up with a sewing needle. Go ahead and try it. I guarantee none of you will do that. Not ever. Nope. And thank you guys so much for checking out the episode today. Really do appreciate it. And as always, thank you to all of you that have subscribed to the channel. For all of you that are new subscribers, welcome. Hopefully you guys go ahead and check out all the previous episodes of US 101. Thank you guys for liking the videos, for sharing them, leaving comments in the comment section down below. It means the world to me that I can constantly engage with you guys in some sort of dialogue about all these episodes and all these episodes in history. You can follow US 101 on Facebook, Instagram, Snapchat, Twitter, patreon.com/US101 if you guys want to pledge some money to the show so you can help us grow and get new equipment. And in turn, you guys get some really cool rewards like this pint glass that's done by Classic Etching. It's a US 101 pint glass that you can get for pledging some money to the program. And that being said, guys, I will see you next week for an all-new episode of US 101. Until then, I am all done. See, did you guys see the new addition to the US 101 wall? I added the Constitution. Took me a while, but it got there. Let me know what else I should put on this wall. I want to get a Rosie the Riveter picture. That's where I want to. But the Norman Rockwell one. That one. Woo, that's badass.